Thank you, Stefan. So great to be partnering on this project with the Salish Sea Focus for the winter quarter. When we were scheming about this series and talking about who could do it justice to sort of kick off and give a whole ecosystem view of the Salish Sea, I said, if we could get Joe Gatos, it would be awesome. He'd be the perfect guy. And I was so happy when he said yes. So we're so thrilled to have you here. Joe has an incredible background and knowledge of the ecosystem. He has been working on Salish Sea issues with Sea Dock Society since 2001, and I've had the pleasure of knowing him since literally his first week on the job. But I have to tell you a little known secret that you won't see on his CV is that he talked his way into that job, a marine science job, with a background as a large animal veterinarian. So if you're worried that you're in the wrong major and it's going to box you in for the rest of your life, rest assured there's tips for changing your career path. Since then, he has devoted himself completely to Salish Sea issues and has a really impressive array of science and research. He is extremely well respected in circles, policy circles, science circles. Joe is frequently the go-to guy. You'll see he has an incredibly positive nature, and that also helps. He has co-authored two books on the Salish Sea, and they're actually for sale right over there in the corner if you are interested getting those on your way out. And just a little other perspective, I think at any given time, you try to reach Joe, he may be off on a radio interview, doing a necropsy, being pulled into a high-level science panel for the governor, or maybe just teaching kids about how to love the Salish Sea. So with that, I'll turn it over to Joe.
Thanks, Jenny. Really nice to be here. Thank you all for coming. And if you're in the wrong room, please just stay. I know that people want to get out of here, so I'm going to keep this to 35 minutes and we'll do Q&A. If for some reason you have to leave, take a sticker on your way out. On the back, there's some Salish Sea facts, three of them. This is a very abbreviated version of the book, so grab those and we'll go from there. So I want to start with the name of the Salish Sea. It's very common out in this area. People know about that. But really, the Salish Sea was named 2009 to honor the Coast Salish tribes and First Nations, people that had been here since time immemorial. And when I first moved here, for me, that was one of the greatest things about this place. I was born a skinny white kid in West Virginia. And my dad was in the military, and we moved every 3 years. Either that, he was a horse thief. I was not sure, but every 3 years, we had to move somewhere. And so we'd do the skedaddle. But really having a sense of place where your people have been and will continue to be and where you won't leave, for me, was really a profound change in my life to be in a place like that. And so I've really, I have a lot of respect for that. When we talk about the Salish Sea, and I apologize, Steph, I wanted to use your map, but didn't have time to call you, that... You know, really, we're talking about a place that's bisected by an international boundary. So this is a 17,000 square kilometer ecosystem. And what I want you to note on this map and then on Steph's, which is even prettier, is that we include not just the ocean, that's 17,000 square kilometers, but we include the land around that. And I think that's really important when you think about this place. We think, oh, it's the Salish Sea, it's sea, it's salt water. No, we're talking about the salt water, we're talking about the fresh water, and we're talking about the land. And the reason is that it's that land that surrounds that, those watersheds that surround this place that capture that fresh water. And just like you see in this image here, all of the fresh water that's coming down around there is going into the Salish Sea. And that's really important because this place is an estuary, and it's what makes this place so profoundly productive from a biological perspective. The water that comes down is really, really rich in oxygen, has some nutrients in there. And we have in our minds, we grow up saying, you know, having this arbitrary boundary between land and sea, and there really isn't one. Everything that happens on land happens in the sea, and they're connected. And I just give you an example, or maybe five examples, of all five species of native Pacific salmon, right? These animals are born, these fish hatch out in the furthest reaches of these little streams and creeks. They migrate out into the Salish Sea, sometimes very rapidly. Sometimes it takes them a year to get out of the Salish Sea. They may go as far as Japan or Alaska, eating, feeding, putting on 90-some percent of their body weight out there, and then they're coming back to the Salish Sea after 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, maybe even 7 years, going back up that same river, up that same stream. They die, and then where does their body go? Their body goes into the land. And you can even find those stable isotopes from the ocean that are in the trees that are there on the stream. Those big, here you see some maple trees, but big western red cedars and things like that. But they're not the only animal that shows us that connection. This one does too, right? Now this is not a robin trying to drown itself. This is an American dipper. An American dipper makes its living by eating insects in fast-moving streams. So it dives under the stream, even though it doesn't really have webbed feet or anything like that, catches insects. But guess what else it's eating? Salmon eggs, right? So here's a bird that never goes to the ocean, doesn't have a beach towel, doesn't even have a bathing suit, yet a very big portion of its life is dependent on eating this really fatty nourishment, these salmon eggs that may have collected energy as far away as Japan or Alaska, right? So that connectivity is there. And if you're not an animal person, if you're like a physical oceanography person, I'll give you this picture. Okay, this is the Fraser River freshet. And what it is, all the snow is melting in the Fraser River watershed, and it's coming down, and it's coming out the mouth of the Fraser River right at the Vancouver metropolitan area, and it's coming out at maybe as fast as 2.6 million gallons of fresh water a second. Okay, so you can see it from a satellite photo here. And remember I said that's all oxygen-rich water. That's really important because the water that's coming in the Strait of Juan de Fuca is really salty water. It comes from the bottom of the ocean. It's very old. It's been down there a long time. Has a lot of nutrients, right? A lot of whale poop, dead organisms, things like that. Doesn't have a lot of oxygen. So when the oxygenated water comes down the rivers and stream, and the ocean water comes in the Strait of Juan de Fuca with all those nutrients, and they mix together when they hit the Gulf Islands and the San Juan Islands like a giant egg beater, and then you throw in a little bit of sunshine, and then you get some plankton that starts blooming, that's what creates the whole foundation for this place, okay? So that's why this place is so rich, because you have all of this energy that's being produced really at this basic level. I mean, it's like having a rainforest. All those, the things that support the rainforest are coming from the sun. Only difference here is they're coming from plankton, right? And we have a lot of animals. So plankton are usually, that means they're kind of floating around, but mostly we think of microscopic plankton. Think about invertebrates, though. So animals without a background. Nobody's really counted, but I think we have over 3,000 different species in this area. Some of them are our world's greatest, biggest, and baddest, right? This is the world's largest chitin, the gumboot chitin. This is the world's largest burrowing clam, the gooey duck, right? This is the world's largest octopus, the giant Pacific octopus. All make their home here, right? That octopus can weigh 150 pounds, probably more than that woman that's scuba diving behind that octopus, right? The number of species that we have, those 3,000 invertebrates, that's cool. That's called species diversity. That's very important from a biological perspective. But what's even more important, and you hear often, is this concept called biodiversity. And biodiversity is not just the number of species you have, but it's about their distribution and all of their interactions and all of the ways that they actually play off of each other. So when you look at this picture, another one of the giants, giant barnacle, largest barnacle in the world there, and you see these beautiful anemones, strawberry anemones around it. Now look at the cirri of that barnacle. Barnacles have a very boring life. They have it really crazy when they're little. They attach to a rock, and that's where they spend the rest of their life, right? So they put their arms kind of out, and they go out and they catch plankton, and that's what they do for their whole life. But look at those cirri, and look how much they look like the fins of this grunt sculpin. Okay, this sort of mimicry is the sort of thing that you get going on with this biodiversity, species interaction, species following each other, genetics changing. Also, there's other types of interactions, okay? Think about this. This is called a crimson anemone. Quite beautiful here, and a beautiful photo. And this guy, Mark Chamberlain, did us a big favor because he zoomed in right here. And what you see is this. Okay, this is a candy striped shrimp. So beautiful, so sweet, they had to call it candy striped shrimp, right? This candy striped shrimp lives there with this anemone. It's protecting that anemone from other shrimp that want to eat it, right? And at the same time, the anemone is kind of protecting the shrimp, and the shrimp's getting some food off of it. So these symbiotic relationships also part of that biodiversity. We also have a lot of predator-prey relationships. I know you're looking at that, you're thinking, "What? This is not predator-prey. Show me a falcon grabbing a sandpiper, or show me a cheetah getting a gazelle on the Serengeti." But I'll talk you through this one. So this leather star is going over to eat this anemone. And I'll give you a little video. The anemone, not really taking it lying down though, right? Picks itself up. If it had a head, it reaches over and kind of headbutts him. And then he's like, he's out of there, right? Remember, slow motion. He's like, must get away. Much slower than the cheetah. Now, he doesn't really know that he's going right back because he doesn't have eyes. And the leather star is thinking, if I had a head, I've had a headache right now. And then just when you think you've seen everything, in comes the copper rockfish thinking, okay, maybe there's something for me to eat. All of these interactions, that's what makes this place so cool. All of this stuff happening, right? So 3,000 different invertebrates, maybe 172 different birds. And just like the invertebrates, the birds are having those interactions sometimes with each other. Like this guy's like, oh, I can't even see where I'm landing, right? Or with other animals, these predatory, right? Some of them are generalists. This bird will generally eat anything it can fit into its mouth. And some birds are specialists, so this bird is a specialist. And what you see here, this is a rhinoceros auklet. So this is a bird that's kind of our counterpart to a penguin. Dives under the water, uses its wings to fly underwater to catch these little schooling forage fish. These are called sand lance here. And that's how it makes its living, which is kind of cool. And then you think, wait, how does that bird catch one fish, come up, get a breath of air, go back down, catch another fish without losing the first fish, right? So thanks to the Seattle Aquarium, got a nice picture here. It actually has these little papillae, these things on its choanal slit and its tongue and its mouth that spear that fish so they can open up their mouth and get another fish. And then they fly back to their burrow under the cover of darkness so the gulls don't steal their fish. And they have a burrow. This is a bird that spent its entire life in the water, comes back, excavates a burrow that may be 15 feet long and has the babies in there, right, at night. So pretty cool stuff. Even the fish are pretty awesome. So that fish, those sand lance, really make their living by diving under the sand. And here you can see one kind of emerging from the sand. All this cool stuff happening, right? Sand lance don't have a swim bladder, which means a lot of fish have a little bladder, so they can float around without expending any energy. Sand lance have to swim all the time. That gets tired. You have to swim your whole life, right? So they say, hey, nothing's happening. There's no plankton for us to eat. Let's go down to the bottom of the ocean. Now, most fish that camouflage themselves, they'll go down to the bottom. It'll be a little bit muddy, and they'll kind of flap around like a bunch of kids at a mosh party, and then some sand and mud will come up, and it'll settle down on them, and then they'll camouflage. These guys are the only ones that really actually dive into the sand themselves. They're tail wiggers, and then they go right under. So we got a video. We had a submarine that we brought up into the San Juans this summer, and a friend of mine took this great video. So what I want you to do, I want you to watch over on the right. Wham. You see that fish go in? This may be one of the first sand lance that people have ever really seen do that. Should we play that again? Watch it. Dives into the sand. Boom. And then it's out of there. Pretty amazing. Now, this is just for me, because so we talk about fish, I have to always talk about my favorite fish. This is called a Pacific spiny lump sucker. There's a lot of lump suckers in the world, both literally and figuratively. So this one we have to call the Pacific and then spiny because it has all these spines on it. But basically, it's a cool fish because it's like a non-fish. It really can't swim. It's taken it's modified its pelvic fins into a little sucker that you can see right here. And so the kids from Victoria High School have a great video I'm going to show you. What you see is just a little bit of current, and this fish is like, oh, God, I can't swim. Sucks itself down, okay? So watch what happens here. I'm going to narrate this for you. Okay, so it comes down, a little bit of current. He's like, got to get out of here. Now look at the gunnel. The gunnel's like, dude, seriously? You call yourself a fish? And the lump sucker's like, get down, man. We got current. We got current here. I don't know why they haven't made a Disney movie out of that whole interaction. But this kind of stuff is happening all the time, right? It's out there, right? And then you see we have other cool stuff. We have about 37 mammals that use this area, probably the highest density of harbor seals in the entire world that we have here in the Salish Sea. And even unto themselves, super cool animals, can easily dive 600 feet deep, hold their breath for 30 minutes. We have animals that use the Salish Sea that you don't necessarily think about. Ones like this mink, and you say, ah, mink, I know, are they really swimmers? They're not just swimmers, they're belly floppers, right? Okay, so think about this place, not as static, but all of these different species out there, all of these interactions, and we're one of the coolest places in the world. We actually have three different species of killer whale, three different ecotypes of killer whale. This one here is a resident. It's a fish-eating killer whale. And here you can see in Monica Weiland's photo, it's coming up from the bottom up to the right. And can you see what it has in its mouth? It has a salmon. Why is that whale bringing a salmon up to the surface? I mean, it could have eaten it below the surface, right? Maybe it's just bringing it up to show Monica it's a resident, right? Fish eater. Probably not. She would know that anyway. Okay, what they're doing is they're prey sharing. These animals have a very cohesive social structure, and they take care of each other, and they share with each other, right? So this is probably a female. The male's terrible sharers, just real life. Females are always like, oh, let me rub your back. Let me get you some salmon. Oh, yeah, I remember when you got me that salmon. And it's very important. It builds this structure with them, right? But the other cool thing is that what happens now when this one of these females has a baby, right? So she has a big baby, right? She's gestating for 18 months. Having pregnancy is one thing. Lactating, a lot more work, a lot more energy. Their milk fat may be 50% milk fat, right? Don't get that in your latte. You put a lot of weight on. But it consumes a lot of energy from the mom. So she can't take care of the baby, and she's dragging the baby behind her, basically, in the slipstream there. So the other whales are feeding her and taking care of her. And you probably remember this summer we had one of our whales, J35, whose baby died. She carried that baby around for 17 days. It was super tragic and almost as if she was saying to the world, you have got to do better, right? And then when Ken Balcom said he saw her without the baby, I said, Ken, how did she look? She looked great. She was fat. She looked good. She was ticked off. Why was she fat if she was pushing that baby around? You can't push a baby around and go catch salmon. Well, the other whales were feeding her, right? They're taking care of each other. Now, and then we also have transients. This population is going up. These are the marine mammal eaters that are in the area. And so to have one giant predator, but to actually have these other giant predators that look exactly alike but fill a different niche, is pretty amazing here. And look at the teeth on this. This is Ken Balcom's photo of a mammal eater that he got when he was in Japan. Look at those teeth. That's like Tyrannosaurus Rex, right? Those teeth are interlocking. You don't want to be in between those things. There's only one direction to go. Now, the third ecotype, the reason I'm showing you those teeth, I want you to look at this picture. Something's wrong there, right? You got needs a dentist. So those teeth are worn down to the gum line. Turns out these are offshores. They're related to the fish eaters. They actually specialize in eating sharks. And if you've ever rubbed a shark's skin, it's like sandpaper. So these animals are wearing their teeth down time in and time in and time in every time they predate something. So it's a pretty amazing place. We have all of these different species, all of these different interactions that are going on all the time. And that's why you see postcards like this that are going on in this place. It's the best place in the world to live. That's why I live here, right? Now, what you don't see are photos like this. It's not a good postcard. Hey, I went to this place, the Crofton Pulp Mill, and I saw some killer whales, right? But I like this photo, Grant, that I think Graham Ellis took this one. Yeah, and because it really tells the story of what actually is going on. We honestly have not done a great job in taking care of this place in the last 200 years. And this is an example of man-made contaminants that we put in the water. So pulp mills used to make dioxins and furans, some of the most toxic, nasty, they call them the top dirty dozen chemicals that we put out there in the world. And these are persistent organic pollutants. We also made PCBs, other persistent organic pollutants, DDTs. These are so persistent that even though we're not making them anymore or using them, they're still in the environment right now. And guess what? They have ramifications. And so in the case of killer whales, these animals are getting them through the food web, they're stored in their blubber, and when those animals get thin, lactation, and need to draw down their fat reserves, or maybe it's in the wintertime and they're not finding a lot of food, they're metabolizing those chemicals, and we think that that's suppressing their immune system. So we've done things that we've done decades and decades and decades ago, we're still suffering from that, right? Here's another picture, people like this one. Oh, that's so good, they're playing there. I like that, maybe they are playing, I don't know. But I put this image up here because I want you to think about noise. We don't think of noise as a pollutant, but our oceans are so noisy now because of all of the ships, all of the boats, oil exploration, pile driving, all of these other things. And with killer whales, we have great science that shows us these animals do the same thing now in the face of all of this noise that people do if you live next to a freeway or you're at a really loud party, right? You talk louder and slower so they can understand each other, right? I always say, same thing my dad does when he talks to a non-native English speaker. It's like, dad, he's not deaf. He just doesn't speak English, but this is my dad. And so they also have trouble echolocating, right? They use their echolocation to find fish, fish that may already be scarce, and then with that increase in noise, it's difficult, even more difficult for them to find those fish. So we're having lots of legacy things that we've done, noise, chemicals, that have changed things. So used to have so many salmon you could walk across their back. Now we have very short salmon openings, right? And then when you have that, remember we talked about all the interactions, the food webs. When you have less salmon, you have less killer whales, right? Actually, 138 different vertebrate species depend on salmon for some stage in their lifetime, right? And animals we don't even think about, right? This bear. And so, you know, there are places still in the Salish Sea where bear come down and eat salmon. Probably not very often in Bellingham, but maybe it happens at night occasionally or things like that on the Nooksack. And so you start to lose, as you start to unravel this place, you start to unravel things that used to be here. And then it resets our mind that we have the shifting baseline. People don't think of bears. You think of bears in Alaska eating salmon. You don't think of them in the Salish Sea. We do have them. We still have them. We even have grizzly bears just much, much farther north, right? And so what else do you lose? You lose a way of life and you lose an economy, right? So this is a picture from Lummi Island Wild that are reef netting. This is an old traditional Coast Salish way. So not only are we not really reef netting very much anymore like the Coast Salish used to, actually, salmon is not a big money-making fishery like it used to be here. All the canneries that used to be here, all the jobs. What are the big fisheries now? Invertebrates, cucumbers. Anybody have a California cucumber for lunch today? Probably not, right? They all go to Asia, right? And it's not just the harvested species. So cucumbers, urchins, crab, that's our big fishery. That's our big moneymaker now. And so we've over-harvested stuff that's been there, and now we're fishing down the food chain. The other thing, it's not just, like I said, not just species that we've harvested. This is a Western grebe. Bellingham Bay used to have flocks of thousands of Western grebes. Somebody sees 60, 80, 100. They call people. They put it in the Audubon newspaper. I saw 60 Western grebes. Okay, and a lot of that has to do with what? What we've done and changed the food chain. So the herring runs that used to come in here in the springtime, the Cherry Point herring, things like that, when those go, the animals that eat them go, right? And it's not even just the Western grebe. I think Jenny passed out a paper for reading that we have 113 different species that are listed by one or more jurisdictions. So the U.S., Canada, Washington State, or the province of British Columbia. That's a lot of species, right? But if you look at even of the percentages, 13% of the fishes, 37% of the birds, 32% of the mammals. That's a third of the birds and mammals in this area are listed as threatened or endangered or candidates for listing. That's not a good sign that we're doing a good job of taking care of this place. So I mentioned habitat before. Even, we don't even think about habitat. You know, these Western red cedars could grow very commonly. 1,500 years, Dr. Marco Hatch showed me one in his building that they think is 2,500 years old that somebody brought in. And if you cut down all of the trees that are 1,500 years old, how long does it take to grow a new one? 1,500 years. That's a long time. And these trees produce habitat, right? They produce cooling shade for the streams, for the salmon. They were fed by the salmon that came back. There are places where birds live. They kept the water cool. You know, so as you start to lose that, you change the habitat, and then the whole place changes. So you may be in cutting down trees, but then you're affecting salmon, you're affecting killer whales, bears, things like that. So we've done a lot, and we're actually facing a lot in this place. And a big thing that we're facing now, people don't like to talk about it, is really climate change. And one of the things with the ocean that's a little bit different on land that's really, really important is sea temperature change. We're seeing warmer and warmer waters. And what you get with warmer waters is that you can get potentiation of diseases because some invertebrates have very relatively simple immune systems. So maybe their water increases, they're more susceptible to getting a virus or something like that. You also see animals actually moving. So animals that occurred farther south may start moving up and creeping into this area. Animals that needed colder temperatures, they actually start contracting and moving farther north. What happens? You start bringing in new animals to an area, right? New fish that are swimming up here, you know, because it's warmer in the area. Well, those animals are bringing in new parasites, new pathogens in areas sometimes for fish or animals or invertebrates that have never been exposed to those things before. So the ocean is changing, and it's actually changing really, really rapidly because of the climate change. So this is the carbon dioxide that we've been putting out into the air. We've thought, people said when we were in school, hey, the ocean is infinitely buffered. Well, we actually know that's not true. And you see the last one up there, ocean acidification. And I'm not going to go into carbonate chemistry, mostly because I don't really understand it myself. But basically, all of this CO2 that we've been putting into the ocean is not able to really buffer it anymore. And what it's doing is the ions, the acidic ions, the hydrogen ions and things like that, they're making the ocean water, they're making the pH drop of that water, okay? And you just go, oh, what am I going to get in? It's going to be like acid. That's not really how it works. But just very subtle changes in the pH can start changing the way that organisms who make shells make those shells, right? Because part of making a shell is carbonic acid, right? Or carbonate. So what you see here, look at these pteropods here from Nina Vidarsnik. So you see a healthy one here, and then under the scanning EM, and then look at the damaged one. You see the shells. This animal can't make a shell the way that it's supposed to. Now, there's no organizations out there like, I'm in the Save the Pteropods group, and we're coming unraveled because of this, right? No, but we think about it. What about salmon that are feeding on pteropods, okay? So things that we actually do care about, do pay attention to, are important for our life, way, our economy, are still being affected by this. Okay, what about things that are big money makers? Big part of our economy is really cultured shellfish. Well, what happens when you start changing the pH, and this is of a Pacific oyster, and you look up under normal conditions and then lower pH conditions, and you start to see that those shells are not producing. And even now, shellfish companies in Washington State have moved their hatchery, their early hatchery operations, to places like Hawaii, where they don't have this acidification of the water, so they can actually hatch out the really microscopic parts of their Pacific oysters or their clams. Then they ship it back here to grow it up once it's actually gone through this. So ocean acidification is, I like it because it's not like a feel fact, right? Chemistry is like physics. You don't believe in it. It's happening, whether you believe in it or not, right? And it's already happening. It's not like, oh, ocean acidification is coming, maybe. No, we actually know that we already have it and we're already suffering consequences from it here. So I see you all getting super depressed. So I'm going to show you a nice picture. One of my daughters and her friend running naked across the beach. And this is kind of how we always think, like, this is the relationship we want to have with the ocean, right? We want to love being out there. We want to love that place. We want to take care of it. And this is kind of where we're going with it, right? Not such a good ocean relationship, even a nearshore relationship with that, okay? So now comes the good part, okay? What can we actually do about it? Because I don't want to send you home just all depressed, like, oh, we're screwed anyway. Let's go out the bar. So here's one option. Very important one in the program that I work for and a lot of people here at Western Washington University are doing is science. So we wear cardigans, we smoke pipes, we draw on chalkboards, things like that. But really, the beauty of science, right, is that it's an arbiter of truth. We have a way that we can actually test things and test them over and over again and feel like, hey, we have a pretty good idea that if we did that again, the same thing's going to happen. So it gives us a starting point to have conversations about what's going on or about how do we fix something or are we actually fixing it and what are the benefits of doing that. And I'm just going to give you a couple broad-based scientific examples of some of the work that CDOC has done in the last 18 years. Okay, remember we talked about southern resident killer whales? Okay, we funded a project a long time ago that actually looked at Chinook salmon as a source of these persistent organic pollutants that were getting to the whales from the salmon. And guess what? Also getting to people because we're eating the same salmon as the whales are eating. You remember I talked to you about the birds, one third of the birds listed as threatened or endangered. And this is really not even a bird we have here. I just love this photo. This is an Atlantic puffin. But we did a study where we did kind of a risk assessment, kind of like when you hear from the doctor, if you keep drinking a six pack a day and smoking two packs a day and eating, you know, your meat-based diet, you have 10 times as likely to have a heart attack. So we did that for birds. We said, okay, which birds are in decline, which birds aren't in decline. Let's look at their life history strategies. Fortunately, none of them smoke, none of them drink. It was more simple, but we found that if you are a bird that dives for a living, dives under the water like that rhinoceros auklet, eats schooling forage fish, not hunted, that you're about 18 times as likely to be in decline. We don't just have a bird problem, we have a forage fish problem, food availability for those birds. And that's science that allows us to now focus some energy to say, what are we gonna do about bringing back or enhancing forage fish populations in the area? What can we do to protect them? Okay, sometimes you have things, outbreaks like this, sea star wasting disease. You may remember this in 2013, where all these sea stars are just melting away. People are totally freaking out. They're calling, they're saying, hey, my dog just ate one of those. Is his tongue gonna fall out? Or my kid just picked one up and I feel like his finger's loose, it's gonna come off. You know, but we were able to say, okay, we don't know what we can do about it, but we're able to use science to show that there was a virus that was responsible in part for what was going on. And what we know about this virus, it's not a virus that people get or that your dog's gonna get. We think it's specific to the sea stars. So even having information when you can't do something, science can be important for that. Now, what about science that enables you to do something? We have really good data. We have one species of abalone here, pinto abalone, also called northern abalone, that we stopped harvesting recreationally in 1994, went back in 2004, and they were even more depleted, right? So we need to figure out, how do we recover those? Well, we're able to fund a lot of really cool, great scientists in the area that worked on, how do we grow these up in hatcheries? How do we outplant them? What size do they need to grow to? How many of them are gonna survive? Well, if 10% of them survive when you release them at a year, then we can actually back calculate how many do we need to release, right? So it's just mathematical type of modeling that you're using from empirical evidence that you're doing out there. And so now we're on the precipice of listing the abalone here in Washington State, state listing, and then not just doing the science, but a science-based abalone recovery program. So when you're old and gray and stuff like that, and you're up here talking to a bunch of students, you can say, I remember we weren't allowed to harvest abalone when I was in college, but now we are, we're bringing it back, okay? Science enables you to do cool things like that. Or birds, this is a scoter. We have three species, a surf scoter like this, white-winged scoter, black scoter. Scoters have declined 50%, largest biomass in birds lost in the entire Salish Sea. And we don't really know why, but we did have concern that people were still hunting them. So we're able to do, again, some math type science. We're able to look at hunter harvest populations. These birds can live to be 17 or 18 years old. They don't reproduce successfully every year. They don't even reproduce until they're after their third year. And we're able to show that, hey, actually in a couple places, four counties in the area, these birds are being over harvested and it's not gonna help the population. So then we're able to go back to the Washington Fish and Wildlife Commission and say, I want you to think about changing harvest restrictions. And guess what? They said, that is a good idea. Let's change harvest restrictions. But we couldn't have just gone to them and said, oh, we feel like you're shooting too many. That's like a field fact. That's not helping them, right? They need empirical evidence to be able to make a change like that. Science can do that. This is a great project, 100% due to Jenny Broadhurst, is looking at derelict fishing gear and what are the costs of that, okay? Jenny worked for the Northwest Straits Commission, had a huge, huge program getting these old lost nets out of the water. And these old lost nets made of monofilament just continue to fish year after year after year. So they'd pull these nets up and they'd say, oh my gosh, look at all the crabs that are dead in that net. And they finally went back, they did a study, really cool study design to see how long animals persisted in that net. Rarely did they persist more than 2 weeks. These are birds, fishes, invertebrates like the crabs here. And so Ginny had this great data set, and my boss, Kirsten Gilardi, and some other people work with Ginny, and they said, okay, we have really good data on Dungeness crab just alone. And this is not the only thing that these nets catch. Look at the crab data. This is what it costs to take a net out, about $1,300, right, to remove a net. That's pretty good. Now, look at the data on how much crab one net is catching, right? Every year, a net is catching $1,966 of crab. So you take a net out, you pay $1,300 for that. That next year you get $1,900 back. How many people want to make that investment? I do. That's a lot of money, right? That's a big return on your investment. And guess what? The next year you still get $1,900 back. And then the next year, this is like a Ponzi scheme. Every year you're getting $1,900 for something you did years ago. And so it's these kind of data that enable people to say, hey, even if you hate crab and you hate birds and you don't care if they're getting caught in a nest, this is making a lot of money for Washington State, right? So this is a good idea. Now, science is good, but guess what? How many people in the general public do you think are reading scientific articles every day? Not very many, right? What are people thinking about? Getting their kids to school? Is it a good school? Are they getting off at the right bus stop? How bad is the traffic today? It's probably just as bad, if not worse, than it was yesterday. Maybe you have some sensitive people. They're in traffic. They're looking out the window, feeling some bad about homelessness. These are the top issues in a study that was done in Seattle. These are what people really think about. Guess what wasn't on that? Ocean acidification, not a top issue for people in Seattle, what they think about everybody. Guess what? Sea star wasting disease, not a top issue. People are not waking up going, really concerned about those sea stars out there. I think I'm going to stay home from work and work on this issue. Okay, so you've got to get people stoked about what's out there, and you've got to get them energized to go out there and to make a difference, or at least vote that they can make a difference and to make an investment in money. And so I'm a scientist, and as much as we weren't trained in this, we now have to do things as scientists. Like, we have to go on TV and talk about stuff, or we have to, like, as Jenny said, we go to a commission. None of us were trained to do that. None of us really like that. But the reality is, people are talking about something. As a scientist, you have data. You need to be part of that conversation. You can't refrain from being part of that conversation. So we're obligated to do that. That's why it's really awesome that you guys here have Salish Sea Institute, work that Jenny and her colleagues are doing, getting people to understand what is the Salish Sea, why is it important, why is it important to us socially, economically, biologically, all of those things. How do we work better with Canada? All of these important issues. There's a lot of people that are working on these things scientifically, a lot of people working on them policy. There are a ton of really important groups that are out there doing this work right now. As Jenny said, I had the good fortune a while back of becoming friends with Audrey Benedict. And with Audrey, we were able to write two books. We wrote this one on the Salish Sea, just to give people an idea, a sense of place. We wanted to know this place, wanted to connect to it. And then once you know it and you connect to it, you want to protect it. You want to take care of it. And it was a fun book, but we started thinking, what about all those little kids that how are we going to get those kids jacked on this place and loving this place? And so then Audrey and I were able to write another book for fifth graders, which is when fifth graders start learning about science, these next generation science standards. They're learning about ecosystems and trophic levels. I talked to my daughter's fifth grade class one time. They sent me letters, and my daughter, thanks for coming in, Papa. I never knew about trophy levels. It's like, oh my God. Got to talk down to this a little bit. Don't talk trophic levels. But they get it, right, when you actually explain to them and enunciate. Now, another thing that was really interesting is we started talking about this. Audrey and I, we said, we'd make this cool book. What if only the kids whose parents have money read this book? That's not good, right? Who does ecosystem degradation affect? It actually affects kids who live in places who don't have money. So we have a project now raising money, giving books to kids that are in Title I school so they can get them for free. Another thing we're doing, we're working on a Salish Sea Wild series. You can find it on YouTube and subscribe. We just had the first one come out. Another way to get people to realize this is an amazing place. We don't really talk for an hour about ocean acidification. We say, let's talk for 10 minutes about something cool. Let's get people excited enough to want to take care of this place. And that's what this is for. So I'm just going to wrap up here, but I want you to realize, as Jenny said, you know, whether you're a science major, whether you're journalism, communications, computer science, political science, or whatever major you haven't decided, all of those skill sets are needed to take care of this place. So you don't have to be a marine biologist, or you don't have to be a large animal veterinarian who fakes his way into a job to do this stuff. You can do what you love, whether that's writing or making videos or policy or science, and you can use that to take care of what's here, because this place is important, okay?